So it's truly my sincere pleasure to introduce Robert and Tove to you today. They are both dear friends of mine, and I've known them for years and been a long admirer of their work. They are
likewise.
Thank you. They are internationally leading scholars in English and multilingualism and language rights, and in many ways have shaped these fields. Both of them have published widely, hundreds of articles and dozens of books. And I would venture to say that they've probably, between the two of them, published at least twice as much as everybody sitting in this room combined. So they have truly been prolific scholars that have changed the face of these disciplines. I just have a few examples of some of their key works, and of course, as I said, hundreds of articles and dozens of books, but just two examples. Robert's 1992 Linguistic Imperialism book was influential in changing the face of English studies from the 1990s onwards and raised awareness about sociopolitical and historical forces that have shaped what global English teaching around the world is. So that's a key work. If you haven't read it, especially if you're an English teacher or English teacher-to-be, highly recommend it. Tove has written what might be called the Bible, and you can see from the pictures of it why it is, the Bible of language rights, and this book was published in 2000 and has been used as a resource both by scholars and by government officials to guide the analysis and the creation of linguistic minority policies worldwide. So another key piece of work. I also want to plug their most recent work, which is this four-volume set on language rights. And you'll be happy to know it's available here at Lund University's library for anybody who's interested in seeing it. So we bought the book, so congratulations. I'll pass around the flyer, which has the table of contents, so you can see what's inside there. It's an excellent resource, collection of a monumental scope of work in this area that's fantastic to see together as a group. They've both been active as researchers, of course, but as role models, they've also been active in advocacy and engagement with governments, with NGOs, with educational institutions to do real change. Many of us in scholarship wish that people would listen to the things that we do and that our work would actually make a difference to people's lives. And I can say that through the work that they've both done, they've made real and permanent differences to the lives of many linguistic minorities in local communities around the world. So for that, they are also excellent role models. They are leading influences also in an area known as language ecology, which is the study of the relationship of languages and their speakers in the social world, and also the relationship between linguistic diversity and biocultural diversity. So all of these are themes that are going to come together in today's talk, which has the umbrella title of Is Global English Compatible with Local Language Ecologies and Principles of Language Rights, or a Neo-Imperialist Project? And I understand we'll hear two pieces of this presentation from them and then have a discussion afterwards. So I'll turn the floor over to Robert. Please join me in welcoming them to our debate.
Thank you very much. Great pleasure to be with you. And we will try to restrict ourselves to half an hour each because we really would love to have dialogue with you. So basically I'm going to quote Obama initially. He launched a project called English for All. The U.S. Department of State and Peace Corps have launched English for All, a new initiative highlighting the U.S. government's commitment to helping people around the world learn American English. And at the bottom of the screen, you can see that this is to be done by getting young people in America to go around the world teaching English. So it is all in the sense of the whole world's population. I'm afraid I have to read from the screen. I don't want to turn my back on you at all. But the complication of the technology was that I can't read on the screen down there, unfortunately. So what Obama is doing is actually continuing a tradition which started with George Washington, who wrote in the 18th century that he saw that the USA was a rising empire. And there's a nice link there between Washington as the person, of course born in Britain and a general by origin, and the Washington Consensus, which has been the way the whole neoliberal world order has been implemented over the last 15 years or so. After the Second World War, Harry Truman, the whole world should adopt the American system. The American system can survive in America only if it becomes a world system. And Barack Obama again, here's my bottom line, America must always lead on the world stage. There is a belief that the Americans have the right to influence matters worldwide. So on the one hand, you have the second president of the United States, John Adams, saying in 1780, English is destined to be in the next and succeeding centuries more generally the language of the world than Latin was in the past or French in the present age. At the same kind of period, Lord Macaulay, who was briefly in India as a kind of spin doctor for the company, which then represented British exploitation of what was Bengal at the time, not even India. But he wanted the people who were subjected to higher education to become a class of persons who would be the link between the British dominant people in the economic and political world, and military, of course, and the rest of the population. He wanted a class of persons who would remain Indians in blood and color, English in taste, in opinion, in morals, and in intellect. And this is very largely what was implemented in colonial education throughout the British Empire, in fact. It's often been linked to the propagation of Christianity, and here we have a recent body, the United Society of the Propagation of the Gospel, a foundation which has a team of people witnessing at grassroots level that Christianity is not anti-Chinese or solely Western. It's very interesting that Christianity should be seen as somehow having nothing to do with the Middle East at all. As missionaries are still banned from China, it represents one of the most, it meaning English teaching, represents one of the most effective ways to support Christians in China through the sending of teachers of English from overseas. There are hundreds, possibly more than hundreds, of individuals who are teachers of English as a foreign language, TESOL, both from the United States and to a lesser extent from the UK, but probably continental Europe to some extent, who do go out as teachers of English, but whose main idea is to convert people to Christianity. There's a huge book analyzing this, edited by two people in America. Suresh Kanagaraj is quite well known in the applied linguistics field. Mary Wong is a missionary, also very astute applied linguist. So there's a book which basically has about 25 people saying, God has called me to use English this way worldwide, and about 25 of us who have written saying we think that this is actually penetration of an educational field which shouldn't entail converting people to a different cultural universe and religion. So it's a very lively dialogue there in the book. And I do have a handout of texts which we could send around, I suppose. So I have a lot of suggestions for how what I don't squeeze into the next 25 minutes will operate with any follow-up that you might have time for. If you look at colonial education in Africa, it was almost entirely in the hands of missionaries until the 1950s. It was something where the state was more or less hands-off and became increasingly involved in the whole process of decolonizing and the independence, formally at least, of African countries from the roughly 1961 in Africa, whereas in India, of course, independence came much earlier in 1947 and in Sri Lanka. What then is the strength of this wonderful language, English? Well, in India, it is nowadays very much the language of privileged castes. But here's an article which I found by chance in the glossy magazine of British Air once on a flight by a guy who wrote in this case, it wasn't until he was 18 that himself, Chandaria Chamar, and the name Chamar is a cobbler. It's somebody who makes shoes, and they're at the bottom of the pile in the caste system in India. He realized that God spoke and understood English and nothing else. Because unfamiliarity with the lingua divina was a matter of intense shame at Delhi School of Economics in the 1970s, he started learning English on the sly and continues to be consumed by the process to this day. Over a period of 3 years after his master's degree, no fewer than 108 Indian firms found him unfit for gainful employment. While doing his PhD in the 1980s, he found that at universities in the US, even those not fluent in English were treated as human beings, a dignity that not everybody seemed willing to accord him in Delhi. He's been hiding in the US ever since. So this says something about the role of English as a language of the elite and privilege, and the way people who are lower in the social structure have little chance of ever becoming competent in it, and even if they are competent, of getting work. So I quoted Macaulay earlier. Have any of you heard of David Graddell?
Yeah.
He's a British academic entrepreneur who has written several influential reports for the British Council, the British government's body for cultural collaboration worldwide, and strengthening the teaching of English, which I actually worked for 9 years before I escaped into academia. So Graddell is very much, in my view, and I document this in a couple of my articles, perpetuating the hierarchy of English as opposed to other languages. And I'll give you some examples of this a bit later. If you look at the English Next India report by Graddell, as quoted by the Director General of the British Council in his annual report 2009, English Next India tells us that from education to the economy, from employability to social mobility, the prospects for India and its people will be greatly enhanced by bringing English into every classroom, every office, and every home. This is the British goal for language policy in India. We're helping English to reach people regardless of income. Later, last year, the British Council has worked with 2,348 master trainers throughout India who themselves reached over nearly 500,000 teachers who in turn taught 17 million learners. So the British Council now is an entrepreneurial body making money out of the teaching and testing of English and consultancies and undertaking work to shape the learning of English in many countries. To me, the idea that people who know nothing of Indian languages or not much about English culture should somehow be qualified to ensure that Indians learn English adequately for Indian needs in the modern world is a myth. It's in my view, completely fraudulent. The British publishers doing it as well. Cambridge University Press, 90% of its activities take place outside the UK, and the biggest markets are China and India, and they now have an office in Hyderabad, the Philippines, and a few other places. This is mainly for the sale of reference works and textbooks for learning English. Oxford University Press, much more active earlier in English teaching, Oxford University Press had offices in many of the big former colonies in the colonial period, several in India. But last year they trained more than 250,000 teachers across the world and had training workshops, over 1,500 across 400 cities in India last year, in India alone, involving more than 100,000 teachers. So the publishers themselves are influencing what's happening in terms of what teachers are being told is useful for them. I don't dispute that it may be useful, but it's a question of how this kind of language policy fits with broader language issues of the use of all languages, which is what Tove will be talking about. But basically, Macaulay in the early 19th century wrote a very influential report which denigrated, stigmatized the local, all local languages, everything written in, even languages which had a written language culture for 2 millennia, which there were several of in India. He glorified English and our culture and rationalized the relationship between them. Graddell, 2 centuries later nearly, writes, Indian learning of English is inadequate. The UK has the solution to India's problem. We're here to help solve your problem. Point four, Macaulay produced a rationale for a technocratic mission and ignored the wider economic rationales and goals. Graddell also focuses only on English learning and basically writes that the UK is not in it for the money, which is not true. And Macaulay ignored the address, the fact that India was occupied militarily by the British. And Graddell doesn't connect his work to strengthen English with global strategic interest, even though this is exactly what the government of the UK is interested in. So basically you have a choice then between Churchill, who I'll quote later, and a Gandhian vision of what education in India might consist of, and I'll quote both of them. But this is the cover of one of my books that was translated into Italian. Gandhi wrote in 1942, "I'm afraid our universities are the blotting sheets of the West. We've borrowed the superficial features of the Western universities and flattered ourselves that we have founded living universities here. Do they reflect or respond to the needs of the masses?" Obviously, he felt that they didn't. And in the 1940s, I can't remember how many universities there were in India, probably 20 or 30. There were three from the middle of the 19th century in Bombay, Calcutta, and probably in Madras. But of course, they were British universities and were using a British curriculum entirely and would have been doing that still in the 1940s. Nehru again wrote, "Language is a unifying factor and is also a factor promoting disunity. I'm convinced that real progress in India can only be made through our own languages and not through a foreign language, English. I'm anxious to prevent a new caste system being perpetuated in India, an English-knowing caste separated from the mass of our public. That will be most unfortunate. I cannot conceive of English being the principal medium of education, medium of instruction, in India in the future. That medium has to be Hindi or another regional language. Only then can we remain in touch with our masses and help in uniform growth." Unfortunately, Nehru's policies did very little to achieve this. And the number of languages used as medium of instruction has been falling regularly in recent decades. So
it's,
I think,
it's growing now.
What?
It's growing.
It is growing now for reasons which Tove might point out, with the use of tribal languages in some of the regions of India. Yes. Doesn't alter the fact that clearly English is a caste language of the elite in India. Churchill in Harvard in 1943, when he was given an honorary doctorate, thanks to his friend Franklin Roosevelt, wrote a policy which connected to American and British interests in the economic and military and political spheres, historically, of course. And in addition, he wrote, "This gift of a common tongue," this is British English and American English, "is a priceless inheritance, and we may some well become the foundation of a common citizenship." Very odd idea. Cecil Rhodes wrote this in his will in order to try to bring the Americans back under the British Empire. It's very fascinating historically to think of these things. Churchill again, "I like to think of British and Americans moving about freely over each other's wide estates with hardly a sense of being foreigners to one another." He, of course, did have an American mother. "But I do not see why we shouldn't try to spread our common language even more widely throughout the globe. And without seeking selfish advantage over any," oh no, imperialism, never had anything to do with that, "possess ourselves of this invaluable amenity and birthright." So we people who are born British, which I am, although I've lived outside the UK most of my adult life, we have a birthright. We're born to promote English worldwide. And he wrote something very fascinating as well. "The power to control language offers far better prizes than taking away people's provinces or lands or grinding them down in exploitation. The empires of the future are the empires of the mind. Have you heard of the knowledge economy?" Very, very astute. He was an astute guy in many ways. Also an imperialist, of course. When did the English profession, which Francis and I have been groomed into, get established? Well, the first conference on English as a world language was held with Carnegie money in New York in 1934. Lots of British people, lots of Americans. And they agreed on the goal of spreading English as a world language on the basis of UK-US collaboration. And this led to US funding of activities on both sides of the Atlantic in the 1930s and again in the 1950s, with the creation of departments of applied linguistics, the birth of the English language teaching professional, now it's a $1 billion industry, and then professional associations in America, TESOL, IATEFL in the UK, which started out as national bodies and are now becoming intentionally global. And then, of course, the exam systems, the TOEFL, which also, and IELTS, which also influence how English is taught. Interestingly, of course, what is totally absent from all of this is connecting with the way English as a foreign language was learned successfully on the continent of Europe. This was a different paradigm altogether from the way this type of English teaching, which is what I was inducted into in 1964, and Francis probably had a more modern version, hopefully. Why do I link this to great power pretensions? Because people like Thatcher have accumulated a lot of money through their influence. She has a foundation, at a right-wing foundation in New York, Heritage, in Washington, which explicitly states on its website that the goal is to ensure that the US and UK can lead and change the world. And in my view, this is something that all of the British prime ministers in recent years and the American presidents are part of and actively state in many of their declarations. So this connects to my initial question about whether we're doing something about global diversity, the ecology of languages, or whether there is an imperial structure which is strengthening English at the expense of other languages. And here you have the financial rationale from Gordon Brown in the short period when he was Prime Minister, quoted in the Sun newspaper. I don't honestly rely on the Sun, and Google has just refused to use... Is it the Daily Mail? Yeah. Sorry, yes, quite right. Yes,
I don't think they ever have the Sun.
No, no, they're both Murdoch products. Yes, sure. Anyway, they wrote then that Gordon Brown will pledge to support the English language to the world, export it, sorry, and boost our economy by billions. He believes an extra billion people around the world will be speaking English in the next few years, which may or may not be true. Depends on the extent to which English learning is effective or not. But he believes that English teaching will quickly become one of Britain's biggest exports. That's even incorrect. It was already a big one when this was produced over a decade ago. It could add a staggering 50 billion a year to the UK economy. So clearly, the British have a massive financial interest in strengthening English worldwide and the industries connected to it. If we look at what has happened in post-colonial education, I have a quick example from a brilliant Nigerian sociolinguist, Bamboche. African language policies are generally characterized by avoidance, vagueness, arbitrariness, fluctuation, and declaration without implementation. So if you like, that leaves things to market forces, which of course strengthen the position of English, unless there are measures in place to consciously strengthen other languages, a bit like Swahili, say, in Tanzania. Here we have an Indian, brilliant Indian, head of the Center for Indian Languages in Mysore, where Tove and I have spent a lot of time. Central Institute, yes. Okay. And he writes then, the modern third world child, among other things, is the victim of globalization. By claiming English as the only global language and the only chance in life, denying their mother tongues and neglecting their regional languages, schooling distances them from their culture, their family, their traditional knowledge and vocation. It enhances the distance between haves and have-nots. If English is supplemented and complemented different local, regional, national languages, then it would be a tower of strength. As a substitute, it is debilitation. This issue, of course, is just the same when the use of English in higher education in this country is discussed, and whether it's in balance with Swedish in a healthy way, and what's happening to this fluid area. But clearly the consequences are much more severe in a country like India. We have the Kenyan novelist and social theorist, Ngugi wa Thiong'o, written several books on decolonizing education and decolonizing our minds, which means Western minds as much as African minds. There can be no democracy where a whole people have been denied the use of their languages, where they've been turned strangers in their own country. There can be no real economic growth and development where a whole people are denied access to the latest developments in science, technology, health, medicine, business, finance, and other skills of survival, because all these are stored in foreign languages. And as you may know, Ngugi was a successful novelist in English as a young man after a colonial education, and then has switched into writing in Kikuyu with translation into English to strengthen the readership of African languages. A very influential person. He's been shortlisted for the Nobel Literature Prize for the last at least 2 years. Quite rightly. another one from Tanzania. I won't go into that. It's the same sort of message. In my work on linguistic imperialism, clearly I connect language policy to imperialism structures in culture, education, media, communication, economy, politics, and military activities. It's about exploitation. It's structural in the sense that more resources go into a dominant language and infrastructure and so on. But it's also a matter of attitudes and beliefs. It's ideological. It's hegemonic because dominant languages tend to be internalized as there, as being there in a normal or natural process rather than as a result of certain forces. It entails unequal rights for speakers of different languages. If education is subtractive, meaning if you learn English at the expense of the other languages, then clearly this is a very severe attack on the integrity of other languages and their use. And it's a form of linguicism, which Tove may refer to in her paper. It was her term initially. And clearly linguicism is inequality by means of language structures and ideologies in very similar ways to sexism, racism, and classism. It's not straightforward one way only. It's a push and pull thing. It's a supply and demand factor. And it will often be contested and resisted. So that the presence or absence of linguistic imperialism in any given context is an empirical issue, but to analyze it, one needs to be aware of these variables and how they influence what is the position in language policy. At present, there is a very strong set of forces behind English, and this is a quotation from two Sri Lanka researchers. The vast amount of money that was made available for universities in Sri Lanka, this was at the end of the civil war, or independence war for the Tamils in the north of Sri Lanka, would not have been possible outside of a context of coercion by the World Bank and other interested parties, such as the US, to regress to English-only education. In other words, no education in Tamil or in Lankan, which is true at university level when these policies were administered. And on the handout, which has gone round to you, I have some examples of the way British aid to education has been simply putting money into the wrong type of activity. And I have ways of denouncing that, which are from some of the sources which I have in the list of reading. It's partly a question of influencing school systems in Bangladesh and in China, or failing to influence them in the Chinese context, and the way the testing industry operates at the moment. I mean, the idea that TOEFL or IELTS are somehow culturally neutral, are completely independent of culture, is of course is an impossibility. And how is this being done by the body concerned, like CEDA or DANIDA, or in the British case, the UK's Department for International Development? Well, under the present government, department has chosen to partner with Coca-Cola. And the Girls' Education Challenge is led by PricewaterhouseCooper, who are accountants and a global business. There's an education project in Kenya managed by Adam Smith International, which, as the name shows, is a British pro-privatization consultancy. So the British government is trying to privatize health and education worldwide, starting in former colonies, but who knows? And then the final bullet there on the screen, a key partner is Pearson, which describes itself as the world's leading learning company with 40,000 employees in 80 countries, and which provides learning materials, places of learning, technologies, assessments, and services to teachers, professionals, and students. And in 2013, it had sales of £5 billion and a profit before tax of 382. They're in it for the money. And the scandalous thing about the language rights books that Tove and I have just produced for us is that this is part of Routledge, which is part of a big thing called Informa, which is also producing profits like that for shareholders. And that's why our four books on language rights cost £900, believe it or not. I'm delighted your library has found the money for it. And what is shocking and tragic for us is that our idea was that this would be made accessible to people worldwide who need the books. And the chances of this happening with this publisher policy, where Routledge is behaving just like Pearson, promising massive profits to people who invest in it, rather than trying to democratize education and give everyone a chance of surviving. So Britain is leading the world in using aid to push for the increasing privatization of health and education. And there's another example there of private schools in Nigeria, Kenya, and Pakistan, and using soft power, as they call a thing like a language. And then this is implying that aid is a tool of Britain's wider policy agenda rather than actually a means of helping to reduce poverty. So the ideology that we're supposed to be helping to eliminate poverty is under these kinds of pressure at the moment. I should add, in closing, I hope within my 30 minutes, that of course I have nothing against anyone becoming maximally competent in English. I mean, even British people can learn foreign languages. Inte på svenska nu. Yeah, tyvärr. We've only lived in Sweden 3 years. And actually, English is our main working and home language, although I understand Tove's Finnish Swedish as well. Okay, so in the modern world, in the pleasant structure, and of course, the expansion of Chinese, not least by the Confucius Institutes, is being modeled on the British Council's activities and the way English is being promoted worldwide. And who knows where that will lead? It's a very open question. I mean, we've met people in, say, Mauritius, who would have liked perhaps to go and get a medical training, doctor's training in the UK or somewhere else, but who can get it in China for a tenth of the price. And they're learning Chinese in order to make that possible. So, I mean, there are lots of ways in which the dominance of English may well be being undermined in other ways. But the question of English really is how you should become competent, how competence in English should be achieved, and in what sort of a balance this is with competence in other languages. And this issue needs to be addressed at all levels of national education and in the corporate world, in the media, in international organizations, for instance, the European Union, where, for instance, did you know that Swedish has the same rights as English in the European Union? Do you think it's used as much in the EU system as English or French? And what will happen with Brexit, which in my view is a catastrophe, but won't necessarily change the present hierarchy of languages.
I think English will become more European as a result. It will not be British English, it will be some kind of Irish European English.
Yeah, may well be, yes. It's already a very...
Yeah. I know, because I was the translator for the European Union from English, and uh-huh. Texts are usually not written by native speakers.
No.
That is a challenge.
Absolutely, and it's a very specialised, legalistic kind of language in any case, yes, sure. It's a very open question, what will happen, yes. But I mean, basically, I finish there with all who function multilingually in our domestic and professional lives know that bilingualism or multilingualism can be achieved when certain conditions are met, and Tove will be talking about these. Thank you for listening. And now she'll try to change the screen so that she can get a picture on the screen as well, with or without Finnish speaking help. We'll see. Vad vill du ha det här? Does it work as well on the table, or should it be?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Oh, you need to fix that somewhere.
Yeah. Well, let's do that then. So. Det skulle vara lika roligt att tala på svenska, finlandssvenska, som ett av mina modersmål, eller finska. Yeah, but I'll have to use English now then. That was what was agreed.
Even more comprehensible in English than in Swedish.
Yeah, we'll see. I won't speak as fast as Robert.
But you should speak loudly, please.
Yes.
You have a hearing aid, and this means that the tendency is for her voice to be...
softer. He doesn't admit that he has a hearing problem too. Okay, I'll start with the dispossession of linguistic capital, prevention of capability development, and promotion of poverty. And I'll follow up from what Robert said. And he hasn't seen what I do, so he promised some things that I'm not going to have. Firstly, competence in an indigenous, tribal, or minoritized language. And I'll use this ITM abbreviation all the time. So remember, indigenous, tribal, minority, minoritized. For instance, a sign language or an immigrant minority language. This competence could be seen as linguistic capital, as something that is a precious and valuable resource. And I'm asking them, is it always seen like that? And my answer is, of course, no. Competence in the official language or languages of a country, and competence in English and a few other so-called international languages, are normally seen as important resources. They are seen as linguistic capital, whereas competence in ITM languages, for instance, Finnish or Meänkieli or Roma or Yiddish in this country, is often invalidated. And then the next question is, how can competence in these languages, for instance, indigenous Sami in this country, or Arabic, Dari, or other immigrant minority languages in Europe, including in Sweden, be invalidated? People's linguistic capital in ITM languages has so far been treated as either invisible or even very often as a handicap. And that would have been valid for instance, the Indian that Robert quoted at the beginning. This linguistic capital has thus been invalidated and constructed as non-convertible, meaning non-exchangeable to other types of capital. Symbolic capital, if we talk about a Bourdieu, national capital, financial capital, or to what I have often used, structural power, material resource power, and non-material resource power. And I talk quite a lot about these and how they are constructed and what they are in that big book. Most ITM languages have been invalidated and made invisible so that they, and also being indigenous or minority or being a refugee, are seen as handicaps, not as resources. And if this is true, then a competence in an ITM language is not convertible to other forms of power and resources. Now then, Robert has mentioned some of the processes through which some non-material resources, like a competence in a language, are validated and others are invalidated. And this has to do with reproduction of unequal power relations, meaning reproduction of the haves and the never-to-haves. Reproduction of unequal power relations through attempts at colonizing the consciousness of people. And I have three processes here: glorification, stigmatization, and rationalization. So what happens firstly is that the majority or dominant group and its language, culture, norms, traditions, institutions, level of development, observance of human rights, etc., are glorified. And I'm sure you could give me hundreds of examples. And when one asks then, does this happen in relation to oral and written official languages? The answer is yes. And languages in international use, for instance, English, yes. And for instance, the Macaulay and Gradle examples showed this very clearly. Secondly, what happens is the ITMs, minorities, subordinated groups, they are stigmatized and devalued. Likewise, their languages, cultures, norms, traditions, institutions, level of development, observance of human rights, and so on. So that these languages and the people are seen as traditional, backward, not able to adapt to a postmodern technological information society, and so on. For instance, and not able to bring up and educate their children. I can see that I have some some errors here too. And if you ask then, does this happen today in relation to ITM people and their languages and cultures? The answer is yes. Also in relation to the refugees and their languages and for instance, can the Turkish parents in Malmö, in Rosengård, can they bring up their children? No, they are not able to do that, and so on. And the last one, which is the most important, most dangerous one, I think, is that the relationship between these two groups, the dominant group, their languages, and the dominated groups and their languages, and so on. This relationship is rationalized economically, politically, psychologically, educationally, sociologically, linguistically, and so on. So that what the dominant group or groups do always seems functional and beneficial to the ITM's minority subordinated groups. And think of, for instance, Peace Corps or the so-called aid that we give to these countries, when in fact it is a brain drain from their countries to us, so that we get formally educated people whose education has been paid by those countries. Development aid to us, of course. But the dominant group is then helping and giving aid and civilizing and modernizing and teaching democracy, like for instance after the Soviet Union fell, there was a lot of teaching democracy to the Baltic countries that Americans and even the Nordic countries were involved in, granting rights, protecting world peace, and so on. And teaching English subtractively is part of this rationalization. And it happens in relation to official national languages and English and ITM people and their languages and cultures. Now then, if these languages have been invalidated and they and being ITM are seen as handicaps, then the competence in an ITM language, the ITM people's linguistic capital, is not convertible to other non-material resources, for instance, formal education or jobs, to other forms of capital, material resources, or to positions of structural power. We could ask today in Europe, also in other countries, what might this mean for the status of refugee, asylum seeker minorities, languages and cultures in Europe? The young ITM people's attitudes towards parents, what would it mean for that? Their attitudes towards their own languages and cultures, the parents' knowledges, norms and ethics, their religions and so on. Will the youngsters be made to look down on and feel ashamed of all of this, so that they do not want to learn any of the parents' languages, cultures, norms, and so on? Just like indigenous tribal peoples earlier and now. So we are reproducing exactly all the sins, crimes that have been committed towards indigenous peoples earlier and now too. Today. Often the immigrant parents' linguistic and cultural capital has been the only capital that they have in the new country when they have immigrated or when they have come as refugees. And if this only capital that they have is not transmitted to their children because of the stigmatization and invalidation and the structural racism in education, then what kind of capital do these young people develop? Often they do not have a chance to develop the kind of educational and other capital that the dominant society values and validates, because this capital is mainly developed in formal education. So they are left without any kind of capital. Even when some or even many of today's young asylum seekers may have more formal education, meaning non-material capital, than their parents had, or that that, for instance, labor migrants had, and even some financial capital. Similar stigmatization and rationalization may lead to dispossession, which is David Harvey's term, and Robert and I claim dispossession of their linguistic, cultural, and educational capital. And through this, it may lead and does seem to lead to capability deprivation, which is Amartya Sen's term, and he has a lot of theories about this. Amartya Sen was a few years ago economics Nobel laureate. And thus, because they experience this capability deprivation, that leads to poverty. And that is in Amartya Sen's theoretical apparatus, one of the main causes for poverty in both, for instance, Asia and Africa today. And one reason for all of this is lack of linguistic human rights in education. And now I'll then say something about whether or not educational linguistic human rights exist. And first I'll ask, could education linguistic human rights be used to de-glorify dominant languages, including English, and de-stigmatize ITM languages? Could linguistic human rights be used to deconstruct the wrong colonial or neocolonial rationalizations, neo-imperialistic rationalizations of the relationship between official dominant languages and ITM languages? Could they be used to revalidate ITM languages and cultures? And fourthly, could they also be used to revitalize indigenous languages? And I won't have time to talk about that, which is a pity, because that's what I have been working with very intensely for the last 10 years. The most important linguistic human right in education for indigenous tribal peoples and minorities, if they want to reproduce themselves as peoples or minorities, is an unconditional right to mainly mother tongue medium education, which we call mother tongue based multilingual education, in non-fee state schools. And if you think of English medium schools, for instance, in India and many other countries, they are fee paying. All of these good things should happen in non-fee state schools. And of course, all state schools, according to UN declarations, should be non-fee, meaning primary education should be free from fees. This mother tongue medium education should continue minimally 6 to 8 years, preferably longer. And there's an incredible amount of research showing this in many countries, including in the United States. And of course, this education should also include teaching of a country's dominant language as a subject, and this teaching should be given by bilingual teachers. So, for instance, in Sweden, the teaching of Swedish as a second language should be given by bilingual teachers. A teacher of Swedish as a second language who does not know the student's mother tongue is, per definition, incompetent as a teacher of Swedish as a second language. And it should also include teaching English if this is not the country's dominant language, and this should also be taught by minimally bilingual teachers. All of this is something that we know from lots of research. Now, do we have then linguistic human rights making this possible? No, we don't. And if we look at binding educational linguistic human rights today, they are more or less non-existent. Language is one of the most important ones of those human characteristics on the basis of which people are not allowed to be discriminated against. So if you look at a lot of the human rights documents, they list a lot of human characteristics. The ones that are always there in these declarations are gender, race, so-called race, and religion, and language. So those four are in all of them. But still, when you go to the educational paragraphs of binding human rights instruments, language very often disappears completely. And for instance, the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights mentions language on a par with race, color, sex, religion, etc. in its general article. But when we come to the education article, 13.1, it explicitly refers to racial, ethnic and religious groups, but omits here reference to language or linguistic groups. And here you have what it says about education. So no language there. If language is mentioned in the binding education clauses of human rights instruments, these clauses then have many more opt-outs and modifications and alternatives and clawbacks, meaning they give some right to language and then they claw it back in the binding parts. There are many more of these than any other articles. And if we look at the UN Declaration on the Rights of Persons Belonging to National or Ethnic, Religious and Linguistic Minorities, and note that linguistic is in the title. This is now a declaration. It is not binding, and it is never going to become binding. It's just something like a bit over 20 countries, states, that have ratified it. I have obligating and positive measures in blue italics and opt-outs in red bold. And when you look at what it says about identity, it's just blues. States shall protect and shall encourage promotion and so on. And there you have also the linguistic identity. And states shall adopt appropriate measures to achieve those ends. There's only one opt-out, meaning appropriate. But when we come to the language part, then it's just read. States should, not shall, should take appropriate measures so that wherever possible, persons belonging to minorities have adequate opportunities to learn their mother tongues or to have instruction in their mother tongues. It's only opt-outs. There are no obligating terms there. And if we look at the latest that we have in Europe, the two Council of Europe's Framework Convention for the Protection of National Minorities and the European Charter for Regional or Minority Languages since 1998, and these are the latest we have in Europe. If you look at the Framework Convention, it is just red things, nothing positive, nothing that obligates the state to do anything about the languages. And if we take both of them, they are full of this kind of things, as far as possible, meaning in relation to languages and the right to learn the languages. Within the framework of the state's education system. For instance, Denmark says, yes, our education system says the language of education has to be Danish. Appropriate measures, adequate opportunities if there's sufficient demand, and so on. And that means that in both of these, the opt-outs and alternatives, especially in the European Charter for Regional or Minority Languages, they permit a reluctant state to meet the requirements in a minimalistic way, which it then can legitimate by claiming that a provision was not possible or appropriate, or that numbers were not sufficient or did not justify a provision, or that the country allowed the minority to organize teaching of their language as a subject at their own cost. So, the maintenance of linguistic diversity is counteracted by the increasing dominance of English and other killer languages, and dominant languages in every country function as killer languages. These languages are then often learned subtractively at the cost of their mother tongues instead of additively in addition to mother tongues. And Robert finished with saying it's perfectly possible under certain conditions to become high-level bilingual or multilingual. That would be additive learning of other languages. So subtractive teaching through the medium of a dominant language replaces ITM children's mother tongues. It subtracts from their linguistic repertoire. additive teaching through the medium of the ITM mother tongues, with good teaching of the dominant language as a second language, adds to ITM children's linguistic repertoire and can make them high-level bilingual or multilingual. They can learn their own language, languages, and other languages well. Now, many people say, oh, this is romantic, this is absolutely a dream, can't be done, because granting all children basic linguistic human rights in education costs too much. And that's a very big, big issue. I'm just telling you, no, it doesn't cost more. Very often it costs less in the long term, and I just give you a few names. Go to my homepage and to the big bibliography and look up these names. And in addition, what human rights lawyer Katarina Tomaszewski, who was the United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Right to Education, said in or wrote in 1996, the purpose of international human rights law is, firstly, to act as correctives to the free market, and secondly, to overrule the law of supply and demand and remove price tags from people and from necessities for their survival. And this remove price tags from people, that the first thing that happened there internationally was, of course, finishing slavery, taking away price tags from people. And linguistic and cultural rights in education are, as human rights, necessities for survival. Price tags should be removed. So even if it were to cost more, price tags should be removed. But it doesn't cost more. Third part, linguistic and cultural genocide in education, subtractive education of ITM children as a crime against humanity. And in a report that the then president of the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, Ole Henrik Magga, and I and three other people wrote a report for this UN forum, we showed that the education of indigenous and minority children in most countries today violates the right to education. We also showed, and especially later, Robert Dunbar, a human rights lawyer, and I have shown it in many reports, this education can sociologically, linguistically, psychologically, and educationally be termed genocide. Legally, it can already now be seen as a crime against humanity, according to the latest ways of defining what a crime against humanity is. Earlier it was seen as something that can only happen during war, for instance, Holocaust and so on. But the latest definitions from 1998, from the Rome Convention, shows that it can also happen during peacetime, and we have shown fairly clearly that this education can already now legally be seen as a crime against humanity. Now, when one says genocide, most people firstly think that genocide is only killing people physically, not at all. And most people react very emotionally. They are not willing to even think of it or look at the evidence. The Genocide Convention has five definitions of genocide, and two of them fit exactly this education. Robert has something, I don't know what. Yeah, that's about ecology. That's the last point, but yes. Yes, and then there's another handout here too. So Article 2E in the Genocide Convention, forcibly transferring children of the group to another group. And Article 2B defines genocide as causing serious bodily or mental harm to members of the group. And I've added the emphasis. Oh, now I'm going back, sorry. I have a couple of examples only, but in that big book that Francis showed, there are hundreds of examples. Likewise in my and Robert Dunbar's 2010 book. This was a longitudinal study in Sweden by Pirjo Janulf, who looked at Finnish immigrant minorities in Swedish medium education. Then she went back to all of them that she could find after 15 years. And she could show them that of those Finnish immigrant minority members in Sweden who had had Swedish medium education, because then Finnish medium classes and schools didn't exist, not one of them spoke any Finnish to their own children, regardless of what language or languages their partner spoke. And even if these people themselves might not have forgotten their Finnish completely, their children were certainly forcibly transferred to the majority group, at least linguistically. Assimilationist education is genocidal. An African example from Ed Williams from Zambia and Malawi, 1,500 students, grades 1 to 7, and two different kinds of education. The Zambian pupils had all their education in English from grade 1. And it says large numbers of them have very weak or zero reading competence in two languages, even in grade 7. The Malawi children were taught in local languages during the first 4 years, and these local languages were in most cases their mother tongues. They had English as a subject, and they had slightly better test results even in the English language than the Zambian students, and in addition they could read and write their own languages. Of course, all their language competencies were at a fairly low level, but still this is true. They knew English better than those who had been educated completely through the medium of English. And its conclusion is there's a clear risk that the policy of using English as a vehicular language, meaning as the medium of education, may contribute to stunting rather than promoting academic and cognitive growth. And this fits exactly the UN genocide definition of causing mental harm to these kids. And I just have one Canadian report here, which tells about Canadian Inuit students who were taught completely in English, who are neither fluent nor literate in either language. And the report presents statistics which shows that the students end up at only grade 4 level of achievement after 9 years of schooling. So English medium education has caused mental harm to them. And some conclusions: subtractive dominant language medium education for ITM children prevents access to education because of the linguistic, pedagogical and psychological barriers that it creates. Thus it violates the right to education. It very often curtails the development of the children's capabilities, as for instance the Inuit case showed, and it perpetuates thus poverty. And I would hope that you would read Amartya Sen on this. And now then, if we look at how Amartya Sen has been applied in this kind of educational issues about language, I quote Mishra and Mohanty, who have written edited a very big book on poverty. The question, if we are interested in more equity in the world, in reducing the gaps, is what is the most critical and cost-effective input to change the conditions of poverty, or rather, in Amartya Sen's sense, to expand human capabilities? And they claim that there is a general consensus among the economists, psychologists and other social scientists that education is perhaps the most crucial input. And that means that the wrong education through the medium of a dominant language that prevents ITM children from developing their capabilities to the full is one of the most important causes leading to poverty. Having access, so-called access, to schools physically changes very little if the teaching language prevents children from access to knowledge and reflection and academic achievement and cognitive development and so on. In addition, this subtractive dominant language medium is organized against solid research evidence about how best to reach high levels of bilingualism or multilingualism and how to enable these children to achieve academically in school. Dominant language medium education for ITM children can cause serious physical and mental harm. Here I can then say that it has harmful consequences socially, psychologically, economically, politically. It can cause very serious mental harm, social dislocation, psychological, cognitive, linguistic and educational harm, and partially through this also economic, social and political marginalization, which we can see, for instance, very clearly in the US, in Canada, in Australia, in lots of countries in Asia and in Africa, and in the Nordic countries, when it comes to both indigenous peoples and also immigrant minorities. Those who have not managed because of how their education has been organized, but despite of it, and that's incredibly important to remember. And those who are dropouts, they have not dropped out, they have been pushed out by the way the education has been organized. It can also cause serious physical harm, for instance in residential schools, and as a long-term result of marginalization. And we know that a lot of indigenous peoples are overrepresented in statistics about alcoholism, suicides, especially suicides of young people, incest, violence, and so on. So, linguistic human rights in education are one necessary but not sufficient prerequisite in the struggle to prevent linguistic genocide and crimes against humanity. And a summary of this, and there's repetition here, schools participate even today through assimilationist genocidal subtractive education through the medium of dominant languages in processes of linguistic capital dispossession and reproduction of poverty. Linguistic human rights might be one way of preventing linguistic genocide, promoting integration and defending people against forced assimilation, promoting positive state policies towards minority languages and minorities themselves, promoting the maintenance of the world's linguistic diversity, promoting conflict prevention, including conflicts that may include terrorism. I could talk a full day about that, especially in today's situation. They could help in promoting poverty reduction and promoting the ecolinguistic health of the planet. And that's the last of my topics, and I will have to be very short on that. Robert, don't look at this. I know fully well, and I still have almost 10 minutes. Sorry. So, biodiversity and linguistic and cultural diversity. And a summary is that much of the knowledge about how to maintain biodiversity and healthy ecosystems is encoded in the small ITM and local languages that linguistic genocide in education is killing off. And I say read Skutnabb-Kangas and Harman, and Elina has been nice enough to copy that article, which is in press, which has much more about it. Some of the things that I don't have time to say anything about. So, some important reasons for maintaining all the world's languages instead of killing them off. Firstly, linguistic diversity and biodiversity are both correlationally and increasingly also causally related. We know the first one very well, and the second one we start having quite a lot of evidence for that too. So much of the knowledge about how to maintain biodiversity is encoded in these small languages, that subtractive dominant language medium education, also in English, and especially in English, is killing off. Through killing these languages, we kill the prerequisites for maintaining biodiversity and healthy ecosystems. And some drivers, meaning the causal factors in this, have to do with the connection of this education and this killing of languages with globalization, with linguistic neo-imperialism that Robert was talking about, with enforced homogenization, and with the ideology of growthism. And again, I would love to have time to talk more about that. So, correlation between biodiversity and linguistic diversity. using biodiversity hotspots, and there are definitions in that article that you, that Elina has copied for you, using these hotspots as a benchmark against which to compare language richness, Gordon Flohr and others found, and I quote, a remarkable concordance in which 70% of the world's languages are found in the 25% of the planet's land area that is considered either a biodiversity hotspot or high biodiversity wilderness area. Doesn't want to go. Then, languages are today being killed faster than ever before in human history. Optimistic prognoses say that at least 50% of today's spoken languages are extinct, or at least no longer learned by children by the year 2100. Pessimistic but realistic prognoses say 90 to 95% of today's languages will no longer exist. And UNESCO uses both of these percentages. Biodiversity is also disappearing fast. The evidence is incontrovertible that recent extinction rates are unprecedented in human history and highly unusual in Earth's history. Our analysis emphasizes that our global society has started to destroy species of other organisms at an accelerating rate, initiating a mass extinction episode unparalleled for 65 million years. So, lack of linguistic human rights, especially in education, is co-responsible for not only so-called illiteracy, lack of school achievement, educational waste, poor life chances, and disappearance of groups, nations, peoples through forced assimilation, but also killing of the world's languages and linguistic diversity, and through that, killing of traditional ecological knowledge, which is a prerequisite for the maintenance of biodiversity. So, subtractive dominant language medium education for ITM children, and remember, English medium education in Africa and Asia minoritizes not only minorities, demographic minorities, but large parts of the population. So this applies to them too. It may lead to extinction, to the extinction of ITM languages, especially indigenous languages, thus contributing to the disappearance of the world's linguistic diversity. And a partial result of this can be, and is increasingly, the disappearance of the knowledge about biodiversity and its maintenance, and through this, diminishing prerequisites for human life on Earth. Most of the world's mega biodiversity, as I showed, is in areas under the management or guardianship of indigenous peoples. Most of the world's linguistic diversity resides in the small languages of indigenous peoples, and much of the detailed knowledge about maintaining biodiversity is also there. This knowledge, when the languages disappear, is not transferred to the replacing languages, and there are studies about this already. And if we continue as now, most of the world's indigenous languages, which are over 4,500 of the world's around 7,000 languages, will be gone by 2100. And finally, this comes from Colin Baker's review of my 2000 book. In the language of ecology, the strongest ecosystems are those that are the most diverse. That is, diversity is directly related to stability. Variety is important for long-term survival. Our, meaning us humans, our success on this planet has been due to an ability to adapt to different kinds of environment over thousands of years, atmospheric, for instance, ice age and so on, as well as cultural. And such ability is born out of diversity. Thus, language and cultural diversity maximizes chances of human success and adaptability. And that means that biocultural diversity, meaning biodiversity plus linguistic diversity plus cultural diversity, is essential for long-term planetary survival of us. because it enhances creativity and adaptability and thus stability. Today we are killing biocultural diversity faster than ever before. And of course the planet might be able to continue without us humans, but it's sure that we can't live without all those healthy ecosystems. And last quote, Vandana Shiva. I hope you all have read most of her books. She's fantastic. She says, ecological multiples are insurance. In any crisis, uniformity is the worst way to respond. Diversity is resilience. So, is this what we really want? Meaning, killing our prerequisites for human life on this planet? And if not, we need to answer the question in today's paper. Is global English compatible with local language ecologies and principles of language rights? And it isn't. Or is it a neo-imperialist project? Yes. And we have to start acting now. Thank you.